Hello, I'm James Abraham. I would like to welcome you to Emerging Approaches in First-Line Therapy for Metastatic Colorectal Cancer, part of the CME-certified Tumor Board online series. This case presentation, led by Dr. Alok Khorana, Director of the GI Malignancies Program of Cleveland Clinic Taussig Cancer Institute, will provide valuable perspectives in pathology, diagnostics, imaging, oncology, radiology, and surgery. Joining Dr. Khorana from Cleveland Clinic are Dr. Sudha Amarnath, Dr. Matthew Kalady, Dr. Thomas Plesec, Dr. Cristiano Quintini, and Dr. Joseph Veniero. I hope you find this metastatic colorectal webcast to be a valuable resource.
Let's start off with a brief discussion of the case. This is a healthy 38-year-old gentleman who presented with a 5-month history of constipation and pain with defecation. The patient presented to his primary care physician first. Despite his young age, there's no family history of cancer. This was asked for by the primary care physician. The patient was sent for an endoscopy because of the significant pain while defecation. And unfortunately, this showed a 3 to 4 centimeter mid to lower rectal mass involving nearly 50% of the circumference and possibly invading into the lower rectal valve. The primary care physician was also concerned because there was some pain in the right upper quadrant, so he ordered a right upper quadrant ultrasound, and that suggested liver metastases. So the patient subsequently went on to receive some imaging studies, including a CT scan and an MRI. Joe, do you want to walk us through what the imaging studies showed?
Sure. So the first study is the secondary evaluation of the rectal cancer with high-resolution, high-field MRI. And so we're seeing axial and coronal T2-weighted images that are showing the anterior tumor pointed to by the red arrows in the axial image on the first image and then in the sagittal plane on the second image. When we mag up on the tumor, we see there's at least one point where the tumor goes through the wall of the rectum into the mesorectal fat, indicating that this is a T2 tumor. A T3 tumor. Additional evaluation of the tumor with other sequences shows that there's restricted diffusion in the lesion, which is consistent with a malignancy, in addition to this uniform hyperenhancement of the tumor. In addition to the tumor itself, there's a nodal mass seen in the mesorectal fat on the patient's left. And then subsequently, an MRI was performed to evaluate the liver lesions that were also seen. So the lesions are high signal on the T2-weighted images, which are the axial images at the top of the screen, as well as the coronal and sagittal images at the top and right side of the screen. On the T1-weighted images, it shows up as dark lesions. So we're seeing two of the four identified metastases. And when there was additional evaluation of the liver, looking for more metastases didn't show any more of the specific hepatobiliary phase imaging done in the lower right-hand image shows the lack of uptake in the tumor of the hepatocyte-specific contrast agent that we used in this case to identify additional lesions. The patient also had a PET CT of the body to look for additional metastatic lesions outside, and it confirmed the presence of hypermetabolic lesions in the liver, showing two of the four lesions. The hot spot in the middle of the lower right-hand image is actually a cardiac activity, and it shows the primary tumor underneath the bladder in the upper left image as well.
Yeah, so the patient had sort of some tissue obtained from a couple different sites, and Tom, did you want to speak to what was obtained and what that showed?
Yes, so first there was the endoscopic biopsy of the rectal mass, and that's what these images are representing. The upper left, the two upper images are the H&E stained sections from the mass, and there's extensive high-grade dysplasia and foci suspicious. The arrows on the upper left image show a few glands that are suspicious for an invasive carcinoma, but it wasn't quite diagnostic. Because of his young age, we were worried about Lynch syndrome, and so the two images on the bottom, the MSH6 and PMS2, are immunohistochemical stains targeted at MMR protein expression. Those would be lost in a Lynch syndrome patient, and they're intact in this case. So it argues against Lynch syndrome. They're not 100% sensitive or specific. So, and then subsequently, the patient received a liver biopsy targeted at one of the liver masses, and it shows an adenocarcinoma in the liver that is consistent with a rectal primary, confirming metastatic colorectal cancer. The liver lesion was tested for microsatellite instability again because of his young age, and that's another marker for Lynch syndrome, and that was stable, again, arguing against Lynch syndrome. The other reason for biopsying the liver lesion was for RAS testing, and that was wild type in the KRAS gene in exons 2, 3, and 4, as well as the NRAS gene in exons 2, 3, and 4. Those were all not mutated or wild type.
We've been doing universal MSI screening here at the clinic for quite a while, so that's one of the molecular markers that you tested for. Are there indications where you do this, or do you do it in every single colorectal cancer patient who presents?
So there's basically three major molecular tests that we're doing. We test for RAS, and that has been in evolution, especially recently, and then BRAF gene, as well as microsatellite instability testing. First, with microsatellite instability testing, we're basically screening for Lynch syndrome, and it's actually uncommon for us to test it at the time of biopsy. We tend to wait till resection, mostly because quality of the sample. We have more tumor to test, and we believe the results more. They're more reliable results. This case was different because he was so young and there was a high concern for Lynch syndrome, so that pushed us to test the biopsy, as well as the metastasis, which is unusual. Our usual algorithm is testing the resection in Lynch syndrome screening. For RAS testing, that has also been advocated for years now in terms of testing for metastasis-related testing. And again, that's an evolution. It used to be just a KRAS gene, and now NCCN, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network, and ASCO have advocated for extended RAS testing that we'll probably get into. Mm-hmm.
So we've been doing extended RAS testing for a while. I think this is, the extended RAS testing issue is really important because in the past we thought that maybe a third of patients were RAS mutant, and those patients clearly did not derive benefit from anti-EGFR therapy. What's emerged in the last couple of years has been, and not from directly from prospective studies, but from subgroup analysis of previously conducted clinical trials, that there are other RAS mutations outside of these sort of the standard KRAS testing that's been conducted thus far. And if you have those additional RAS mutations, the likelihood of benefit from anti-EGFR therapy is basically non-existent. And there's at least one study that suggests that there may be worsening of survival if you have these additional RAS mutations. So that's really changed sort of the denominator, right, of patients who can receive, or the numerator of the patients who can receive anti-EGFR testing from about a third of patients to maybe less than half of patients, because now many more patients are identified as RAS mutant.
Look, if I can make a comment just on the MSI testing. So we've been doing, with pathology, universal screening for all colorectal cancer since about 2009. Mm-hmm. And we just recently looked at our studies and the results of those. And we've had almost 1,000 rectal cancers looked at, mm-hmm, over the last couple of years. Microsatellite instability is extremely rare, only about 3% of cases,
okay,
as opposed to about 15% of colon cancers. And for colon cancer, it also makes a big difference because of response to some of the adjuvant therapies like 5-FU. Mm-hmm. But we also found in rectal cancer, about 75% of people who are MSI high have Lynch syndrome. Mm-hmm. So it's very, very rare, but if you do have it, it's also a big marker to make you look further at the family history and actually look at further tests for Lynch.
And that has an impact not just on the patient, but the patient sort of
forced
to get relatives.
It has big implications because, yeah, one, for him, he has to get other organs screened for Lynch. It's upper gut. For women, it's endometrial cancer, and ovarian cancer, urinary tract cancers. But then everybody else in their family has every first-degree relative has a 50% chance of also having Lynch. Mm-hmm. So if that person is recognized as Lynch, then everyone else can be affected with that way too.
Yeah. And you mentioned we've been doing this for a number of years now, but you're part of a panel that recommended universal testing sort of nationwide now. Is that correct?
Correct. And what we found, so the NCCN has gone to say that they think the data is strong enough, both for what it finds out, but also from cost containment process, because, mm-hmm, identifying people and actually getting them screened appropriately and preventing cancers from happening is, in the big picture, saving money, particularly identifying family members as well. The NCCN says anyone less than 70 should be screened. Mm-hmm. We've had a broader picture and screened everybody. We found about 15% of our Lynch syndrome cases actually were picked up greater than age 70, in case that we wouldn't have suspected. Mm-hmm. And particularly in the older patients, that has a huge implication because they've got generations who are in their 50s and generations in their 20s. Mm-hmm. So you've got two generations already subsequently down who are already at risk. So I think for older people, it actually makes a big difference too.
All right. And is there recommendations that you make to the family members in terms of if you are found to be Lynch syndrome positive for surveillance? That changes your surveillance
algorithms. Sure. So first of all, if the person himself has Lynch syndrome, then we screen them very differently. Mm-hmm. There's different cases. So someone who has a cancer, that has already kind of happened. But then we change our surgical management a little bit, which we could talk about later if you want. Mm-hmm. Those people get a colonoscopy every year. And also women will get screened, get an endometrial biopsy and ultrasound every year, transvaginal ultrasound, and also look at the ovaries. People get a urinalysis once a year to look for urinary tract cancers or screening. And then we're also screening the upper gut with EGDs, usually starting at age 30 or so, and then depending on what we find, that interval comes out. Mm-hmm. For people who don't have any symptoms or any manifestations of Lynch yet, that's actually the really important group because mm-hmm. those are the ones who can screen before cancers happen.
Potentially prevent the cancer.
And that's the whole point. So we start screening at age 20 to 25, and they get a colonoscopy every 1 to 2 years, depending on findings. Once you're at age 40, they get screened every year, because the average age of cancer forming in Lynch is about 44. Mm-hmm. So we know that as soon as you get a certain age, the risk is higher and higher, so we screen much more aggressively in those people. Mm-hmm. Colonoscopy has been shown to prevent cancers from developing and prevent death from cancer mm-hmm. in Lynch syndrome, so that's a very, very important test. Mm-hmm.
I think that's a big difference. And people think of colonoscopy as similar to mammography in the sense that it's a screening test, and it is a screening test, but it's also prevention. I mean, mammography doesn't prevent cancers from happening, but if you have a colonoscopy and you find a polyp and you take it out, that polyp is never going to turn into cancer.
That's a great point. I mean, all cancers that we know of develop from a normal to a polyp to cancer. Mm-hmm. And if you intervene at that polyp stage, which is the whole point of colonoscopy, mm-hmm. you can stop cancers from developing.
So that's the importance of screening for Lynch, is not simply there are some tweaks that might be made to the patients specifically, but there's also implications for the patient's family members, right. And so it's really important. So that's why the age cutoff doesn't really make sense, because there's going to be family members who are younger and would still benefit from screening.
Right.
Screening
the thing patient. Is it's less likely when you get over age 70 or 80 that you haven't had something that's shown up before to suspect it.
Right.
But there is still a small percentage of people that have the facts. Right.
Any thoughts just broadly about the diagnostic imaging studies that we've done? So, we did CTs, we did MRIs, and we did PET CT. Is the PET CT that much valuable? Cristiano, you're one of the people who's going to worry about what's going on in the liver. Do you find that adds that much to clinically?
Yeah, and Dr. Veniero can also comment on this, but we typically, as a surgeon, indicate PET scans whenever we think there is a patient with a very advanced disease, borderline surgical candidate with some medical conditions. That's when, in my opinion, there is a role for a PET scan to identify disease that you may have missed that may determine the candidacy of this patient to a surgical procedure, big surgical procedure, to some time. I'm glad to see that this patient received an MRI, because it is by far the best tool we can have to stage this patient in terms of liver lesions. And we've been educated on this by our colleague radiologist.
Yeah. So in terms of the MRI, the looking at the liver with MRI is by far the most sensitive, like you said. And we don't need the PET scan to look for additional metastatic lesions in the liver. Primarily, though, since the PET scan is essentially a head-to-toe evaluation, what we're trying to find is additional metastatic disease that might preclude the patient from having a curative surgical procedure potentially, or indicating a potential additional surgical procedure they could have to make them more curable.
So in somebody like this, where we're, just based on the collection of people who are on this table, we're considering aggressive multidisciplinary management, it's important to rule out distant disease. And so this patient's had this workup. I guess we haven't talked as much about the primary tumor, but the MRI is very helpful for understanding what's going on with the primary as well, correct?
Yeah. There's been a switch from staging these lesions with only physical exam and potentially endoscopic ultrasound to, at this point, we essentially get an MRI, and it's part of the standard evaluation to get a high-field MRI on all the rectal cancer patients, to get an MRI stage so that we can make decisions on pre treatment of the lesions before surgical intervention. So,
so are you satisfied with the workup that's been done thus far? Do we need anything else that we need to get at this point to help make a decision?
So, from a surgical standpoint, I think first of all, this is a much bigger picture. It's a multidisciplinary care. We have to figure out what we're doing with systemic therapy, with the liver mets, with the primary tumor. From a surgical standpoint, the primary tumor is evaluated by digital rectal exam, seeing where is it in, within the rectum, is it anterior, is it posterior, is it low, is it high, is it movable or mobile, meaning it's not attached to the sphincters or attached to other organs.
Right.
So unfortunately, we don't have that physical exam information, but that really plays into some of the things that we think about in terms of what surgery will do.
So we're at sort of this stage now. We have as much information as we need about this patient. We've sort of given away the game a little bit, but this is in terms of, you know, the composition of this tumor board. But this is a paradigm shift to even consider bringing in a liver surgeon and, you know, a rectal surgeon in the discussion of a patient with metastatic colorectal cancer. I think one of the things we need to talk about a little bit is how that, you know, how that's evolved, and why are we considering such aggressive management in a patient who essentially has metastatic disease. So, Cristiano, you've sort of followed this over a period of time. Do you want to speak to you know, why you're here and why
Certainly.
We're talking about liver metastases?
Yeah. So we'll I see at the tumor board our multidisciplinary approach as a pre-flight checklist. You know, there are certain things you need to check, but the checklist helps in preventing mistakes in a critical phase of any activity. In surgery, checklists have been proved to be extremely important to prevent surgical errors in flying. And so having, I think, all the components of the team present in the room forces you to look into every single aspect of a disease that involves several systems and organs, and then obviously there are the cases where there is no black or white situation. So again, having that multidisciplinary approach helps further to in those complex cases.
Just to sort of outline what the options are, we could have the two of you go in and do surgery. And then talk about either radiation or chemotherapy afterwards. We could start off with systemic chemotherapy, or we could sort of sequence it in a different way. Are you eager to go in and do surgery up front in this patient?
Not necessarily. I think they have pretty extensive metastatic disease. From what forces my hand to do surgery up front is what's the symptoms from the primary tumor.
Mm-hmm. So right now he has some pain while defecating, but no real bleeding issues.
Right, so what I ought to be concerned about is there significant bleeding where he's either getting anemic or requiring transfusions, or is he obstructed? Mm-hmm. Those are the things that are going to force my hand to take care of the tumor first, or even just do a diverting colostomy to take care of some of those symptoms, if you get symptoms of obstruction, not necessarily bleeding, where you can get the patient into a better situation, make him feel better, and then go on with the systemic treatment or the other treatment that you need to do. Mm-hmm. So if he's not symptomatic, then we tend to say, okay, what are we going to do first? And my approach, at least, and we'll get the input from everybody, is we want to take care of some of the things that might kill the patient, which mm-hmm. is systemic disease. In that situation, I think chemotherapy is a good first line, and that does a couple things. One, it treats the systemic disease, but then it also gives us a little bit of a hint of the biology of the tumor. Mm-hmm. So if this is a very aggressive, non-responsive treatment, then and after several cycles of chemotherapy, he's blossomed all throughout his liver or throughout his lungs, then we've avoided doing an aggressive surgery that would not have helped that patient. Mm-hmm. So I tend to think in this situation that chemotherapy the first step.
Yeah, so from a medical oncologist viewpoint, I mean, my view on this has evolved significantly in the last few years. So, you know, before somebody presents with stage 4 disease, you know, number one, okay, let's start you on chemotherapy and then we'll figure the rest of the stuff out. And now there's sort of a branch point right prior to that, and that is the patient resectable or not resectable? And I generally don't make that decision on my own. I involve, you know, all of you in this tumor board discussion. So the first question for that I'm thinking about is, Cristiano, is this patient, clearly the, you know, the primary can be taken out, but are the liver mets resectable as they are right now?
Definitely the liver mets are resectable. Very much resectable.
I think one point we're trying to get at too is not just resectable, but resectable for cure. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of a change in the paradigm too. Mm-hmm. A lot of times in the past, you had metastatic disease, there was no chance for you. Mm-hmm. I tell people about 25% of people have metastasis to the liver or somewhere else, and about 25% of them, or maybe a little higher now, are resectable for cure, mm-hmm. and will have long-term durable survival. Mm-hmm. So when we look at, are they resectable, it's not just can we take it out to prolong survival, but actually cure with multidisciplinary approach.
So resectable with a high probability, upfront probability of R0 resection, so margins would be negative and you're confident you can take everything out.
Correct.
So, but how do you make that determination? So how do you decide, I mean, what's the definition of resectability? Because there's no real standard definition, correct?
Yeah, and what I like to define is what is unresectable more than what is resectable. In a way, to me, patients should be considered resectable unless you can prove otherwise. There's a huge survival benefit from resecting a patient, about 20-30% difference in cure. Mm-hmm. Therefore, you must consider every patient resectable unless it isn't. And what's not resectable? Definitely patients that are unfit for surgery, and this is also a moving target. We don't consider age as a limiting factor. We've resected patients that are on their 80s and functioning perfectly fine. We obviously denied surgery to patients that are younger but in a poor functional status. Mm-hmm. The presence of bilobar liver disease is definitely not a contraindication. Studies all around the world have shown that it is definitely a little worse to have bilobar disease than to have just one single nodule, but that doesn't preclude you from achieving cure potentially mm-hmm. on these patients. And the dimension of the lesions is not a contraindication, absolute contraindication for resection. So any patient in which you know you're going to leave at least 25, 30, 35% of liver mm-hmm. behind after a major liver resection is a patient that can, that should be considered for surgery. I gave a range of percentage in terms of how much liver should we leave behind, because that depends also on the quality of the underlying liver that we are dealing with. A patient that had extensive chemotherapy coming from other centers after a year or two of chemotherapy, definitely you should be a little bit more conservative in those patients. But chemotherapy-naive patients with good liver function and no underlying liver disease, you can really be aggressive and pushing the limit as much how much liver you can remove.
So I would definitely recommend that we start off with systemic therapy. So the second decision point now is what are my regimen choices? So you know, historically, if you look at the literature, there's no difference in terms of response rate between FOLFOX and FOLFIRI, which are the two chemotherapy backbones that we use in this setting. Having said that, 70% of U.S. oncologists use FOLFOX, and I fall in that 70% category. There's no sort of real rationale for it. If you go back to some of the studies that were done in the early 2000s, there's a greater rate of conversion to resection of liver metastases in patients who were assigned FOLFOX, although survival was really no different, sort of following these patients further out. So I don't quite know if that's what sways oncologists. Like I said, the data's not really that powerful. And you could choose FOLFOX or FOLFIRI. The second decision is to which antibody to couple them with. In this particular patient, we've done extended RAS testing. And I really want to emphasize how important it is to do extended RAS. We can't just do KRAS testing anymore because that means you're giving 10 to 15% of patients a drug that's potentially reducing their survival and is certainly harmful in the sense of causing skin toxicity and some other toxicities. But we've done the extended RAS testing in this patient. He's clearly RAS wild type in both KN and RAS across all the different codons that we measure. So clearly he could qualify for an anti-EGFR therapy up front. That would be either cetuximab or panitumumab. The other option would be anti-VEGF therapy with bevacizumab. There have been trials of comparing chemotherapy backbone plus either anti-VEGF therapy or anti-EGFR therapy upfront. And the data are a little bit controversial. There are two smaller studies that showed, you know, sort of things one way, but the large intergroup study, which is really the definitive study that answers this question, shows no difference between either approach. So you can start off with either an anti-EGFR approach upfront or an anti-VEGF approach upfront, and it doesn't seem to matter. The one challenge with using an anti-VEGF approach in somebody who's going to surgery soon is the concern for wound dehiscence and wound healing issues. And so if you do use anti-VEGF therapy upfront, then you want to stop the bevacizumab. You know, people say 4 weeks. I feel more comfortable with the six. The half-life of Bev is about three weeks. I feel more comfortable with the six-week stopping point before surgery. I like to let the chemotherapy be closer to 4 weeks prior to the operation, but I stop the Bev upfront. So in this patient, we made the decision to use FOLFOX and bevacizumab, but I think it's entirely reasonable to use with one of the anti-EGFR drugs. And some studies would suggest that maybe the response rates are a little bit higher with an anti-EGFR approach than they would be with an anti-VEGF approach. In the big picture, overall survival is similar between the two approaches.
So look, chemotherapy has changed quite a bit over the last couple of years, and we've seen a big advancement in the introduction of targeted therapies. Can you comment a little bit on that?
Yeah, so for metastatic colorectal cancer, there's several targeted therapies that are available. So, you know, the most commonly used antibodies are the anti-VEGF antibodies. Bevacizumab is probably one of almost the oldest antibody in this setting. And then cetuximab was approved right after bevacizumab. Cetuximab's an anti-EGFR antibody. There have been a couple other targeted agents that have been approved in this setting. So there's aflibercept, which also targets VEGF and can also be used in the setting. The data for aflibercept are primarily in the first-line setting. The data for bevacizumab are in the first-line setting, second-line setting, and there's certainly data to, unlike chemotherapy, that we can continue bevacizumab beyond progression. So you don't just stop at the first-line treatment if there's progression, as you do with chemotherapy, and then switch the chemotherapy over. You can, but you don't need to stop the anti-VEGF antibody. You can continue that even in the second-line setting. The anti-EGFR treatments have also undergone an evolution. So when they first came out, there was testing based on EGFR. I don't know if you remember that, Tom. That was a while ago. But there was no data to show that EGFR testing in the primary tumor was anywhere predictive of response.
Yeah, they did. The first trials were immunostaining for EGFR, and it didn't predict anything. Right.
What did predict was RAS mutations. So RAS is downstream of EGFR, and if RAS is constitutively activated, it doesn't matter what you do upstream because the pathway is on, and so the pathway is going to stay on, and so there's no point interrupting that pathway. The real change has been with sort of RAS testing, not just KRAS testing, but also with NRAS testing.
And yeah, the first was KRAS codons 12, 13, just right. Exon 2.
Yep. And now that's expanded to an additional KRAS codon and then a couple codons in NRAS.
Yes, yeah, right.
Yeah. And the anti-EGFR drugs are very effective in adding to the response. They're effective as monotherapy, whereas the anti-VEGF drugs are not effective as monotherapy. The anti-EGFR drugs are effective as monotherapy, but they're really effective when combined with systemic therapy. So we're in this weird transition phase where, you know, we want to give up chemotherapy, but we can't quite give it up because you need the targeted agents combined with chemotherapy to achieve the maximum response. And in some studies, response rates with anti-EGFR therapy combined with systemic chemotherapy are in the 55, 60, 65. Even when you select out the true wild RAS type patients, they're ranging really, really high response rates. And so, you know, I'm sort of a really big believer, especially in this particular patient, we don't really need to convert the patient from unresectable to resectable. Mm-hmm. But when you're thinking about conversion therapy, so your response is really important. And in that setting, an anti-EGFR approach would add to the response rate. Again, this is all not based on large-scale randomized trials because there's not really a large randomized trial of conversion therapy of unresectable to resectable. But based on the conglomeration of the data and the known high response rates when you combine anti-EGFR therapy with systemic therapy. You know, in the old days, 5-FU alone was systemic response rates were in the 30% range. The FOLFOX, FOLFIRI era in the 45-50% range. Adding Bev, you're getting to the 55% range. The trouble with bevacizumab is there's no biomarker. Selected, molecular biomarker-based selection, you're ranging in the 65, maybe even the 70%+ range. Of response rates. So if response is really important, I tend to use an anti-EGFR agent upfront. There are two of these agents, the cetuximab and this panitumumab. The approved dose for cetuximab is a weekly dose, although some people sort of extrapolate from smaller studies and use an every other week dose. the approved dose for panitumumab is an every other week dose, so that sort of jives a little bit better with the FOLFOX or FOLFIRI regimen, which we tend to use. There's a lot of controversy right now about whether FOLFOX can be combined with the anti-EGFR regimens. There's some data to suggest, particularly in the setting of liver resection, that maybe it's not the right thing to do. There are other people and other trials that suggest that maybe it's okay and it's not a big difference. NCCN's come down a little bit more on the side of the evidence. In terms of practice, though, people haven't changed their practice patterns quite that much. There's other agents that are in the third and fourth line settings. So regorafenib is a drug that's a multi-targeted tyrosine kinase inhibitor, and that's used in further line regimens. There's no data to support its use in upfront therapy. And you don't really see a lot of responses with the oral multi-targeted tyrosine kinase agent in this setting. And so it's not something we use in a patient in whom we are considering curative resection in the setting of metastatic disease.
So Alok, what's in the pipeline? How do you see the field evolving 10 years from now in terms of chemotherapy agents?
Yeah, so there's a lot of excitement right now in oncology as we're transitioning from this phase of chemotherapy to targeted agents, particularly biomarker-based selected targeted therapy. Part of this is driven by genomics. We've been doing genomics using whole genome sequencing or next generation sequencing in a lot of patients, and we can identify sort of markers that may predict response to specific targeted agents. One of the things we've learned from other cancers is that if you have certain upregulation of certain targets, even if the drug was developed in lung cancer, it might work in melanoma or the other way around. And so it's a really exciting time because we are finding some of these agents work based on the mutation rather than based on the tissue of origin.
And you, Alok, you bring up a good point. Given the importance of resectability in metastatic liver disease, we always look at patients that are not resectable upfront over time, because what's not resectable today may become resectable after 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months of chemotherapy. And so it's really a dynamic concept. Resectability is not something that you see a patient, you deem it unresectable, and you stop following that patient up. Things change, and we have also some imaging about great response and conversion chemotherapy, bringing a patient from non-resectable to resectable.
Mm-hmm. Can you comment on how many cycles, well, for both you guys, so how many cycles would you get before you reassess, and how many cycles do you want before? If you know you're going to do surgery, there's some toxicity associated with the chemotherapy to the liver, so how many cycles do you want to do before you move on?
So, that brings up sort of the important point of toxicity, and does one of the, in the past, one of the skepticism about doing systemic therapy up front was that you're delaying potentially curative surgery. We now know that's not really the case, but you are introducing an element of, you're introducing systemic therapy in somebody who is, clearly almost potentially resectable right now. And so I'm going to give him chemotherapy for a couple months. There is the risk of, certainly the risk of nausea and vomiting, but there is a risk of febrile neutropenia. There's a risk of infection. And most relevant to what Cristiano does is the risk of steatohepatitis or fatty deposition that's induced by the chemotherapy changing the way fat metabolism occurs in the liver. There's a phenomenon called CASH, which is chemotherapy-associated steatohepatitis, which is very similar to NASH. This is If you follow patients long enough, it's actually reported, Joe, you often report this in patients who've been on chemotherapy for a long period of time. So it's a real phenomenon. And so we want to be sure that we want to use chemotherapy up front, but we don't want to give so much of it that something goes wrong with the liver resection. In general, the consensus is around 3 months plus minus, a couple weeks. And I think liver surgeons seem to be comfortable with that. Do you agree?
Very much. Unless you're dealing with 1 centimeter or a half a centimeter liver lesions that are going to disappear. And in that case, we try to be a little bit more conservative in how much chemotherapy we do. Mm-hmm. But there are also other ways. If we believe that the patient should receive 3 months of chemotherapy, we are working with our radiologist, we place small fiducials in lesions that are very likely to disappear. So I definitely agree with Alok about the duration of chemotherapy. Mm-hmm.
So for those of us who aren't surgeons, what's a fiduciary and how do you place that?
So like you said, it's a good problem to have a lesion that has responded so well that you can't see it at the time of surgery. Is though a surgical challenge because we have to sometimes resect the wide areas of the liver and we don't know we're doing a curative resection. So at the time of diagnosis, when the patient is diagnosed with a small lesion that we know is likely to disappear, then we go with either ultrasound or CT scan guided intervention, and we place a small little, think about it as a clip, a little clip that we place close to the tumor. And even if the tumor disappears, then we can locate the clip with the intraoperative ultrasound and be quite sure that we are resecting the tumor, even if we can't see it.
Mm-hmm. What about portal vein embolization? Do you do that for unilobar or bilobar disease?
We do that very liberally here at our institution. It increases the safety of big resections and it's based on a very simple concept that the liver has an amazing capacity to regenerate. So if we have liver tumors located in one of the two lobes of the liver, most of the time is the right lobe of the liver, and we're planning to do a major liver resection, what we do is we send the patients to our colleague radiologist that will occlude the blood supply of the side of the liver that has the host most of the tumor, and that will determine the shrinkage of that lobe of the liver, and the healthy part of the liver will grow, so that when we go back and remove the liver, we have created essentially a win-win situation. Mm-hmm. The tumor has shrunken, the diseased part of the liver has shrunken, and the healthy part of the liver has grown. So recovery is much faster under those circumstances.
Mm-hmm. So for this patient, you know, there's still the primary to deal with, the rectal primary. And so the, you know, if he didn't have metastatic disease, we would mm-hmm. be recommending, you know, upfront chemoradiation therapy or at least radiation therapy of some type. But now we're in the setting of metastatic disease, but we're still thinking of cure. And if you're thinking of cure, local recurrence is important, and it mm-hmm. can happen even in the presence of metastatic disease. So would you recommend we do radiation now or hold off or not do it at all? What's your thinking?
So I think absolutely, and I think this is where this multidisciplinary approach, you know, makes a big difference. And I defer a lot to both my surgeons as well as medical oncologists in terms of what they think the curability of the patient is, because then local control becomes a bigger issue, as you said. Ultimately, you know, this patient, based off his pelvic MRI, had a T3 tumor. He had lymph nodes that were questionable, kind of, and one disease in the mesorectal space, but
that
no other.
Primary,
no other lymph nodes that were involved. But it wasn't a very big T3, so the resection margins didn't look particularly threatened.
Right.
Overall. So a lot of this discussion comes back to, again, what our surgeons think and if they need downstaging of the tumor versus no downstaging of the tumor, and that can determine basically the type of radiation that we might offer, whether that's chemotherapy and radiation versus a short course of radiation therapy. Mm-hmm. In this case, and typically in metastatic cases, as long as our surgeons don't require downstaging, we tend to opt for a shorter course of radiation because we want to make sure that they're on full dose systemic therapy as much as possible.
So to clarify, because you know short course radiation is not widely used in the United States.
Sure.
It's one of the standards in Europe. And in the United States, the generally used regimen is about 5.5 weeks or so of either 5-fluorouracil or capecitabine with radiation Monday through Friday.
Right.
So when you're talking about short course radiation, you're talking about
so 5 gray times 5, it's typically given over the course of a week. Actually, most of the locally advanced rectal cancer trials, you know, back from 1980s, 1990s, started with short course therapy. Mm-hmm. So when we look at the Swedish trial, the Dutch total mesorectal excision trial, all of these actually used 5 gray times 5. Mm-hmm. And then long course chemotherapy and radiation became, you know, more favored based off of the North American experience and then the German rectal cancer study that showed a benefit you know, with from a local control standpoint to doing preoperative therapy with long course chemotherapy and radiation. But there's a Polish trial that compared the two regimens, the 5 gray times 5 to the long course chemotherapy and radiation, and basically they have similar efficacy. So we've been doing it a lot more frequently here at the clinic for patients that might benefit from the local control that's added by giving short or by giving some sort of radiation up front, but don't require the downstaging that, you know, comes with a longer course of chemotherapy and radiation.
So for me, I mean, you know, I'm very concerned about this patient's systemic disease. So for me, you know, the fact that we don't have to interrupt his systemic therapy for a prolonged period of time to do long course chemo radiation is very attractive, because that means I can get back on systemic therapy relatively quickly. And for patients, you know, 5 days is of course much much easier than 5.5 weeks. Do you feel any urgency to go in and do radiation right now, or should we start this patient on systemic therapy and you're okay with that?
Again, I mean, as long as he's not particularly symptomatic, you know, I think Matt touched on a lot of the things that we think about. So, you know, obstruction, significant bleeding, things like that. As long as there's nothing that needs to be palliated up front, it makes a lot of sense to start with systemic chemotherapy and then hold off on your radiation until you're going to be closer to surgery.
Great. So it sounds like we all have a consensus that we are thinking cure, even though this is a patient with metastatic disease. We're thinking that there's a lot of opportunities to get there because he's RAS wild type, so we have extra possibilities for systemic therapy. His liver disease is still resectable with a goal for cure, as you keep pointing out, Matt. And his primary is resectable, and it's a matter of sequencing. But I think our consensus right now is that we should start this patient on systemic therapy and then reevaluate after a couple months of treatment and then make a decision about where to go next. So this patient went on to receive 4 cycles of systemic therapy with the FOLFOX regimen, coupled with bevacizumab. And now we have restaging scans to look at post this sort of induction therapy phase. So Joe, do you want to look over what the restaging scans show?
Sure, so these are the same views that we saw in the pre-therapy or pre-neoadjuvant therapy, and shows that the tumor itself, the primary tumor, is decreased in size, so the wall thickening that we saw in the axial images and on the sagittal images in the anterior part of the rectum is decreased, and that conglomerate nodal mass that we saw in the mesorectal fat with the red arrow pointing to it on this slide is significantly decreased in size as well. In addition, when we looked at the liver lesions post-therapy, they have also decreased in size significantly, and the internal enhancement that we saw before the internal enhancement that we saw before is essentially eliminated, indicating that the significant treatment, a significant effect of the treatment on the tumors.
So we didn't cherry pick this case because, you know, you do see the majority of patients do tend to get good responses with systemic therapy, and again, that's a change compared to, you know, 10 or 15 years ago. So for this patient, I ended up stopping the bevacizumab prior to sort of the last cycle of chemotherapy, just to, you know, because we were thinking cure and we were thinking getting him to surgery. So now we have these scans, and there's clearly a good response. There's no new lesion, so that's, you know, for me, that's the number one thing: is there progression of disease? And there's clearly not. And there's been good response locally, and there's been good response at the sites of liver metastases. So, Cristiano, are you happy with this scan in terms of moving forward?
Very much. It's not only the fact that these lesions are becoming smaller, it's also the fact, as Joe pointed out, that this nodule seems to be necrotic, at least for the majority of it. And that's a good prognostic factor, actually, in terms of long-term survival. So I'm definitely very happy about the response.
And Matt, you're happy with how the primary is looking right now?
Yes, it's shrunk some down quite a bit, which is good. We really want to look, as Dr. Amarnath has pointed out, what's the depth of invasion into the mesorectal fat. So there's a nice sheath of tissue around the rectum that contains all the lymph nodes, and it's a very defined fascia there. We're limited by how far we can go outside of that by the narrow confines of the pelvis. And if it goes through the mesorectum and into that mesorectal fascia, there might not be anywhere else for us to go. And if it goes into the pelvic sidewalls, we're at a disadvantage with that. So if it's shrunk down and it's still within the mesorectal fascia and we stay outside those appropriate planes technically, then we have a very good result.
I guess one point I'll make about systemic therapy is that, you know, we tend to focus on the effects of systemic therapy on the metastatic disease. But systemic therapy can, in fact, downstage primary tumors. Mm-hmm. We see that all the time. Now, that's not the same as sterilizing the field with radiation therapy to prevent future local recurrence, but at least you can achieve symptomatic improvement with some downstaging in the primary as well. And that's often overlooked when, you know, when we're making that initial decision about where to start. And so if the patient's not that symptomatic, as this patient isn't, I think it's perfectly okay to start off with systemic therapy because you'll likely achieve control of the primary fairly quickly with systemic therapy. So now that the patient's undergone this upfront induction therapy, you know, one of the decisions we have to make, we've made the decision to do systemic therapy upfront, wait for response, but not go too long. And clearly at this point, there's nice response in the primary, nice response in the metastatic disease. There's really no indication to keep going with systemic therapy, right? This is a good time to sort of take a break and consider resection. Do you guys agree with that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so now for the two surgeons, my next question is, do you want to take the primary out first or the liver out first or both together? And how do you make that decision?
So again, we talk about this a lot and we figure out together what we think we should do. Some of it really depends on what we think is the most pressing step for the patient. Mm-hmm. And then it's also looking at how big is a liver resection going to be and how big is the rectal resection going to be and mm-hmm. how much can they tolerate. If they're going to have a huge liver resection and you have a very difficult pelvis, it might be a big tumor or a very challenging anatomy for the patient, we might not do those together. Mm-hmm. Someone who's young and healthy like this guy, is that a good response? I think we could probably take both at the same time. Then I'd push to do a synchronous resection.
Mm-hmm. So in this particular patient, what do you think, Cristiano?
I think it's very much reasonable. I think...
So one-stage resection is very much reasonable.
Combined resection of the primary and the metastatic disease, yes. Mm-hmm. And I think the rule of thumb is, generally speaking, if you think you will need a major hepatectomy, which means four or more liver segments mm-hmm. in order to clear the metastatic disease, then the consensus is that it's probably better to stage the surgeries. But if you have superficial lesions, like in this case, they're big, but they're superficial. So I think wedge resections are very much possible and indicated in this case. And I think it's very reasonable to proceed with both surgery at the same time. Mm-hmm.
Great. One other thing that we think about, too, is if the patient, so we talked a little bit about short course versus long course. Mm-hmm. And if you have a big, bulky tumor where you think the margin is going to be challenged or threatened, then the longer course is better because you can get more shrinkage of the tumor and actually give you a little bit better response. Mm-hmm. Where a short course, you have the same sterilization process, but you don't have the shrinkage effect. Mm-hmm. So you don't gain that downstaging of the tumor.
But in this case, we've already had the downstaging and...
Right.
So you're not advocating particularly...
No, not for this. But I was thinking, so one of the reasons why we might do liver first is if we're going to need to do long course chemo radiation to get that downstaging, then you might say, well, I still want to take care of the systemic disease the best we can of the liver disease, so mm-hmm. go ahead and do liver surgery first, and then go back and do the chemo radiation because it's going to, again, extend, you're going to be off systemic chemotherapy for a long time. Mm-hmm. While you do that, it's a six-week course of chemo radiation, and then we usually wait about 8 to 10 weeks after completion of that before we do the surgery. So that would be a situation where we'd say, do liver first. Mm-hmm.
I think that's an important point to bring up. A lot of the downstaging that comes from long course chemo radiation is not really because of the dose of the radiation and the chemotherapy per se. It's really the amount of time that you're waiting before resection. The short courses have always been done with surgery typically within about a week after you finish the radiation. So you really are getting the same kind of ultimate dose to the tumor and to the pelvic areas at risk, but you're not waiting long enough to really see that effect pathologically. So
we talked earlier about using short or long course radiation at some point, and mm-hmm. so now we are done with treatment of the systemic disease, and we are sort of thinking you guys are going to go in and take this out. So when's the appropriate time, and what's the decision point between pre versus post operative radiation to the pelvis?
So typically, based off of, the German rectal cancer study, we tend to favor preoperative therapy because there is equivalent local control or increased local control with preoperative therapy, as well as decreased toxicity. We have to treat less normal tissue mm-hmm. if we can do it preoperatively, and that's our goal, is ultimately to, improve local control with minimizing toxicity to the mm-hmm. pelvis. So typically we would want to go preoperatively. If we do short course therapy, the timing is very important, so we have to work in conjunction with our surgeons very closely to make sure that we time that radiation, you know, and coordinate that with what their surgical date is to make sure that we're within that window after they finish their short course therapy.
There's also some of the data on those trials show that the compliance rate of completing your full course of chemo radiation is better if you do it pre-op as opposed to post-op. The other thing that we get concerned about is radiating post-operatively because you have a fresh anastomosis. You've got good healthy tissue down in that area and then you radiate down. It really has significant functional complications for the patient.
So for this patient, are we advocating doing short course radiation now and then going on to one stage or combined resection?
Correct. And I think the other thing just to point out with short course versus long course radiation, the fields that we're treating are exactly the same. So we're really targeting the exact same areas within the pelvis, the primary tumor, typically the mesorectum and the mesorectal lymph nodes that live there, as well as the internal iliacs and the presacral space. So those things don't change between whether you're doing a long course type of therapy versus a short course type of therapy.
All right, so this patient underwent one stage resection of his liver metastases in the primary rectal mass after short course radiation to the primary. Do you want to walk us through the pathology here, Tom?
So this is the APR specimen. and you can see that the shiny surface at the left is the upper rectum or sigmoid serosa, and then the sort of more red area is the mesorectum. And the important thing at looking at it grossly is the quality of the mesorectal excision. This is it. This is, and we have three basic categories, complete, incomplete, near complete, or incomplete. This is complete because it's big and bulky. It looks like it's, you know, part of the serosa. We don't see any muscularis propria or any defects in the mesorectum. So that's a complete mesorectal excision, and that correlates with fewer instances of local recurrence. And then in staging the cancer, these are sections from the patient's rectal cancer, and the upper left shows the tumor invading through the muscularis propria into the perirectal fat, so that makes it a YPT3. And then upper right is a lymph node metastasis, so we have residual lymph node metastases. There's a tumor deposit as well and extramural venous invasion. So to summarize in text format, we have a moderately differentiated rectal carcinoma and it's invading through the muscularis propria into the perirectal fat, YPT3. Three of the 48 lymph nodes that were identified were positive for metastatic carcinoma. All the margins were negative, including the circumferential resection margin. There were several tumor deposits. Five of them were identified, perineural invasion and extramural invasion were also identified. At the time, so these are images from the wedge resections of liver, and there were four wedge resections of metastatic carcinoma in liver. All of them showed viable but treated metastatic rectal adenocarcinoma, all of which had negative parenchymal margins.
So essentially you're saying Matt and Cristiano did a good job and they took everything
out.
Yeah,
I mean, you can see that the tumor was treated, it had treatment effect. There was much more fibrosis and stroma relative to the tumor, so probably an R1 in terms of the treatment response. Still lymph nodes positive, so it's not a complete response. But yeah, I mean, what could be done was done.
And just for any surgeons who might be watching this webinar, I want to say that, so we did a low anterior resection. It wasn't abdominal perineal resections. The decision is basically what's the involvement of the sphincter complex. Mm-hmm. And we also consider the quality of his function. He had good strong muscles. He's 38, he's a young guy. He can handle being put back together and have good function afterwards. But we were able to get below the tumor adequately, still preserve the sphincter complex because it was not involved, and then put him back together again. So he has continuity of his GI tract again.
Mm-hmm. And the patient was reimaged post the surgical resection. And Joe, you want to talk about?
Showing one of the surveillance images post-resection, just looking for residual tumor or recurrent tumor, and you can speak to the time course that would you order them, in follow-up after therapy. But, these are typically done to assess the treatment and to look for, recurrent disease. Mm-hmm. And in this case, we didn't see either.
So, there's obviously an important person missing from this tumor board, which is the patient himself, and we haven't talked about sort of how we present this information to the patient. We've been very focused on making sure, you know, that we go in and, you know, treat the tumor as aggressively as possible. But of course, this is driven to a large extent by patient preference. You know, certainly it's driven by patient comorbidities and patient fitness for surgery and patient's willingness. But when we present information to the patients, we certainly talk about, you know, respect patient preference, ask about patient preference, and not simply patient, but also their caregivers, and make sure that they're on the same page in terms of how aggressive they want us to be. And certainly we would take less aggressive approaches in situations where patients directed us otherwise. I think that's fair to say. But now we're in this stage where, you know, the patient's undergone, you know, a lot of treatment. I mean, you know, several months of chemotherapy with an anti-VEGF antibody, a waiting period, and then this really, you know, we tend to sort of forget how difficult, you know, surgeries can be for patients, but, you know, difficult surgery in terms of the recovery period and the amount of stress that the body's put through. And now the patient's emerging from the other side. And can we talk a little bit about what the expected rate of cure would be in this setting? And then somebody who's had a good response to chemotherapy and has had an R0 resection of both the liver metastases and of the primary. You know, Cristiano, you see a lot of these liver, you do a lot of these types of liver resections. You're certainly not curing everybody. I mean, the hope is to cure some of these patients, you know, as many of these patients as we can. But we also have to be realistic when we discuss, you know, probability of recurrence with patients.
That is correct. And one way I like to approach the discussion with the patient is, yes, it's important to know what is the your likelihood of being alive 10 years from now and being totally cured. Also, like, though, to discuss what is the survival advantage that we give you by doing this procedure versus not doing it. Mm-hmm. And I think it's quite clear that the survival advantage that you give to these patients is about 20-30% in the long term. Mm-hmm. So I tell my patients that they will have 20-30%, sometimes even 40% more likelihood of being cured by the disease and being alive 10 years from now. Mm. And but the, you know, the largest series around the world speak about survival rates 5 years after curative in resections with curative intent of about 40% in selected cases. And but again, it's important to stress to the patient also the alternative. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the patient's been through a lot already, and even though we, you know, I don't want to put the patient through more, in terms of systemic control of disease, in a stage three setting, for instance, which is also a setting where we do surgery and then quote adjuvant therapy, we do at least 6 months of chemotherapy, and so. It's hard for me to say this to patients after they, you know, they've gone through all of this and they come back and, you know, but I still have to have the discussion at this point to say, look, you know, you've been through a lot already, but the ideal until, you know, the new studies come out, the ideal duration of adjuvant treatment in the setting of attempting to achieve cure in combination with surgery is 6 months. That's the best we know. We've looked at more than 6 months and it's not, you know, there's not greater benefit to doing more than 6 months, at least in the stage three setting. But it's at least 6 months. And so certainly in the stage four setting, I wouldn't want to stop with just 3 months of chemotherapy, which is what this patient received prior to the operation. So at this point, I would recommend that the patient move forward with additional chemotherapy to complete a full course of 6 months of treatment. The challenge now is that unlike most patients who don't really get neuropathy until a little bit further in their course, this patient has significant neuropathic symptoms. And he, you know, he's already undergone an R0 resection. There's no sort of residual disease. I would not recommend bevacizumab in this setting because there's no data to show that bevacizumab is effective in preventing metastatic disease in the setting of no evidence of disease. So in stage three colon cancer patients, cancer's totally taken out. Studies have shown that using FOLFOX plus Bev has no improvement in survival versus FOLFOX alone. We're sort of, you know, making sort of extrapolations from stage three disease, but this is a setting where all the disease is out, there's no residual disease. So I would not recommend adding bevacizumab. I would recommend moving forward with some form of chemotherapy. I would like to do full FOX, but because of the patient's neuropathy, we may have to either drop the dose of the oxaliplatin or do just infusion of 5-fluorouracil to complete the full 6 months of treatment. So this patient went on to receive additional chemotherapy and completed a 6 month course, total 6 months of treatment. And after that, we have to have surveillance. As you pointed out, Joe, you know, we have to have a good surveillance protocol. Generally in the stage four setting, so this is different than earlier stages, but in the stage four setting, I would like to see scans at least every 3 months. Do you have a favored imaging modality in this setting?
Well, in general, for recurrent disease, once we've taken out the primary metastatic lesions that we know of, the most economical and efficient method of screening the whole body is going to be CT scans. And so we'll get a good look at the liver to look for recurrent disease. We can look at the resection bed as well, but we're also going to see if there's nodal disease in the retroperitoneum or chest disease in the lungs and so forth. And so that's the most effective way. And unfortunately, in this patient, eventually we found a recurrent lesion in the liver.
So this is a scan that's done you know, some months after completion of all treatment and several months after the liver resection. But as you pointed out, Cristiano, you know, the long-term cure rates are not 100%, they're not even 50%. We're still looking at, you know, maybe the 20-30% range. So this patient falls into the majority of patients who do end up having recurrent disease, even though we've given them time off of treatment and time and a time period where there's no actual cancer present. Do you want to speak to the scan, Joe, and tell us what
it shows? In this case, we're seeing a hypodense lesion in the posterior right lobe of the liver. That's about 2 centimeters in size. That on this scan is, you know, in this setting, is highly suspicious for a metastasis. Mm-hmm.
So now we are entering sort of a data-free zone. So, you know, all the randomized trials are upfront first-line therapy, or, you know, in the perioperative setting. So liver metastases, pre and post-operative setting. You know, there's no not a lot of evidence to guide us at this point. Do we go ahead and resect, or do we, you know, do additional chemotherapy? Do you have a preference, Cristiano? What do you like us to do? I mean, this is clearly resectable, even though it's a recurrence.
You're right, and I usually, obviously, leave the possibility of more chemotherapy to you. There is some literature, surgical literature, that essentially looked at the role of re-resection after recurrence. And there is a role for it. There is a role, and the data shows that the likelihood of you being cured from that recurrence is similar to actually the likelihood of being cured from the first liver metastasis that you get. So, ideally, if you can take the patient to surgery, it's something you should really consider.
So if this scan came back with, you know, 20 liver metastases, you would not make that recommendation.
Absolutely,
but this is
not
based on the burden of disease at the time of recurrence.
Absolutely, yes. Okay. Single lesions. Keeping in mind the resection criteria that you would use for a primary manifestation of metastatic liver disease, then you would consider resection.
Yeah. So I'm okay with going forward with resection upfront. I'm just a little bit nervous about the time interval. It hasn't been that long since we stopped systemic therapy. As you had said about, you know, upfront liver resection, one of the advantages of doing systemic therapy upfront is that it's a temporizing measure. So it gives us time to figure out what's the natural history of the disease. It's one lesion today, but it's going to be, you know, 10 lesions on the next scan. And so I would, even though it's not necessary for downstaging, I would still recommend that we start off with some chemotherapy right now to try and achieve some downstaging. Again, because the time interval between completing the sort of so-called adjuvant therapy after the last resection and now is not that prolonged, I don't want to go back to the same regimen. So my choice would change at this point, and I would recommend an irinotecan-based regimen, and I would certainly combine it with an anti-EGFR therapy, which we could have used upfront, but we didn't, and so now this would be an appropriate time to come in with sort of a completely new regimen, particularly given the short time interval completing treatment and this recurrence. So this patient went on to receive second-line chemotherapy with irinotecan and cetuximab. There's a new scan now after a couple months of sort of reintroduction of systemic therapy.
It started out just over 2 centimeters and it's shrunk down to about 9 or so millimeters. It's much, much smaller in volume, even larger decrease in size than the linear measurement.
Still to a size that would be quite easy to identify with intraoperative liver ultrasound. So
yeah.
Good response, not too good. I think this is easily detectable with intraoperative ultrasound, so I wouldn't.
So this patient had a nice has had a nice partial response to second line therapy with irinotecan and anti-EGFR agent. So is this again a good time for you to take the patient to surgery?
I think so. I think you have a window and you should take advantage of it.
Yeah. One other point I want to bring is kind of bring the case full circle. He's 38 and he didn't have Lynch syndrome. That was one thing we screened for. Mm-hmm. We didn't talk about it much, but we did have him see our genetic counselor mm-hmm. because there are a lot of other things that can cause cancer other than Lynch syndrome in a 38-year-old. Mm-hmm. One of them being MYH-associated polyposis, which is a recessive mm-hmm. Transmitted gene. You might not see a big family history, or you might, so it would be basically a grandparent has something and you might not see it. So he went and saw our counselor, and actually now there's a lot more gene panel tests that are out there too, where you might be able to test 20 to 30 genes that are associated with hereditary syndromes that you might not pick up otherwise. So he did go through the full process, had counseling, had appropriate testing, and we didn't find anything, mm-hmm. which is fortunate and unfortunate. But I just want to say that we know we do explore those possibilities because, again, it has implications for him and for his family. It's called MYH-associated polyposis because it's a genetic defect in the MYH gene, which is a basic scission repair gene. Mm-hmm. So in the process of DNA repair mechanisms, you have a faulty DNA repair mechanism, and then you end up getting unrepaired areas that lead to mm-hmm. lead to tumors. A lot of times, it really depends on where the errors are occurring. So those errors can occur in the APC gene, which is associated with polyposis, and then the MYH gene doesn't then, or the protein that it makes doesn't correct those errors. So you actually have a phenotype that looks like FAP mm-hmm. or familial adenomatous polyposis, and those people can get multiple polyps. So you might confuse the two. The one thing when you're talking about in patients in front of you in the clinic is you look at the hereditary pattern. So FAP is a dominantly inherited syndrome, so the chances are you're going to have a mother or father has the disease and has known, or siblings are also going to have a 50% chance of having the disease. Whereas MYH, it's not so. So if you have a really limited family history or if it skips a generation, you think about MYH mm-hmm. with those people.
Great. So thanks. Thank you for reminding us about that. So, you know, we've had sort of a prolonged discussion about this patient. I think there's a few takeaway messages that I want to emphasize. Number one is obviously multidisciplinary input is critical. None of us can make these decisions in isolation. Certainly the patient's values and preferences are important. Their goals of care are important. But the input from liver surgery and, colorectal surgeon and, obviously pathologist and imaging, all of these sort of shape the decisions that we make. I think the second takeaway message, and again, this is an evolution in how I treat my patients with metastatic colorectal cancer, is that there are some patients that can be cured even in the setting of metastatic disease. And it's not 1%, it's in the order of 10 or 15 or 20 or 30%, depending on exactly how these patients present. So it's really, really important that we bring in, the appropriate surgeon with the expertise in doing these types of operations upfront in the discussion, not because we want to do surgery upfront, but because we want to have that discussion upfront about what the sequence of treatments is, when do we do systemic therapy, when do we do resection, when do we do radiation therapy, and then, how we manage those patients. Genetic counseling is very important, especially in patients with younger age at diagnosis, and unlike the dominant histories in Lynch and FAP, there are other recessive syndromes that may not have as strong of a family history. So young patient, especially less than age 50, right, Matt, would you agree? You want to think about genetic counseling, even if MSI screening is negative. Molecular testing is crucially important. It's partly important for screening purposes and also for determining the type of systemic therapy regimen that you choose. Anti-EGFR antibodies are a great way to treat metastatic colorectal cancer, but they're ineffective in the presence of RAS mutations. Not just KRAS mutations, but extended RAS mutations. And so ASCO has a new provisional clinical opinion that says, don't stop at just KRAS testing, do extended RAS testing, and we've been doing that, and that's certainly something we want to emphasize, is that molecular testing and markers are very predictive of response to treatment, and so those should be done. And finally, even if you do your best and the cancer still comes back, that's not the end of the road. There are still additional options. Re-resection is a possibility. Other systemic therapy regimens are a possibility. New drugs, are approved. We didn't get a chance to get into third line and fourth line settings, and then there's certainly clinical trials available for many patients that fail standard for first and second and third line therapies. So thank you all for a great discussion. We thank the audience for listening in and listening to this very interesting case and to the exciting things that are available for our patients with metastatic colorectal cancer, and thank you for your attention.